Good morning, and thank you for joining us online. And if we can really worship the Lord this morning. As you all know, we lost Ines on Monday night. We really just, as we worship this morning, we really just want to pray and intercede for Peter. The second song we're singing, What a Faithful God We Have, especially for Ines. Ines always asked Angie if she would sing that at her funeral. So it really is, as we sing that this morning, the second song, let's really just praise God and worship God for Ines's life. And then the final song is especially for PP, Days of Elijah. Let's worship him. Father, we do just thank you again for the opportunity to come and exalt, lift up, honor the name of Jesus Christ. Help us to do that this morning. We do pray particularly for Peter, Lord, that the God of all comfort would comfort him, encourage him, strengthen him this day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Of the blind, there's no one like you. There's none like you. Into the darkness we shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no
before your throne of grace, I find rest in your presence and fullness of joy. In worship and wonder I behold your face, singing, what a faithful God.
Thank you.
To hear hearts to really receive and lay hold of what you would say to us this morning. Pray for the anointing, the power, the presence of your Holy Spirit to make your word, life, truth, very bread to each one of us. In Jesus' name, amen. At the beginning of chapter 2 of the book of Joshua, Joshua dies, and then immediately after that, there comes tragedy. In Judges chapter 2, verses 11 to 15, then the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord and served the Baals. And they forsook the Lord God of their fathers, who'd brought them up out of the land of Egypt. And they followed other gods from among the gods of the people who were all around them. And they bowed down to them, and they provoked the Lord to anger. Verse 13, they forsook the Lord and served Baal and the Asherahs. And their anger of the Lord was hot against Israel. So he delivered them into the hands of plunderers, who despoiled them, and he sold them, God sold them, into the hands of the enemies all around, so that they could no longer stand before the enemies. Whenever they went out, the hand of the Lord was against them for calamity, as the Lord had said, and as the Lord had sworn to them, and they were greatly distressed. Then Judges 17, verse 6, the very last verse of the book of Judges, chapter 21, verse 25, both say exactly the same thing. In those days there was no king in Israel. Everyone did what was right in his own eyes. So we go from the book of Joshua into the book of Judges, probably the most terrible book in the whole Bible, most tragic book in all of Scripture. Why is it so terrible? Because it's the book of going from great promise, great hope, to the book of the unfulfilled, unfinished job. In the book of Joshua, the people of Israel went into the land. They had amazing victory after victory, finally moving into God's purpose after 40 years in the wilderness. But before they finished the job, they just began to settle down. In the final chapters of Joshua, they'd already started settling down before the work was finished. They'd heard the great call of God. They'd been shown God's purposes. They'd responded to that. But tragically, before it was finished, they settled down. And so the book of Judges is the story of the terrible tragedy of the unfinished job. And the tragedy of the book of Judges is made far, far worse by the fact that it's still being repeated today, over and over and over again. There are many Christians who make a blazing beginning. They see God's great purpose. They lay hold of Romans 8:28, I have been called according to God's purpose. They get very excited about that. Or they get excited about Ephesians 3:11, my life now is all according to the eternal purpose which He has purposed for me in Christ Jesus our Lord. And it's wonderful and it's exciting. And they respond enthusiastically. But then there are many who go so far, but they stop too soon. They lose the vision. They lose inspiration. They lose all sense of purpose. They lose the get up and go to get up and get on. And what you once saw in their faces and what was so clear, the shining of God in their faces is gone. They were so positive, so occupied with the things of God and heaven and eternity. But now something's happened. And often they're not even aware that it's happened. But when you speak to them, you don't get the response that you once used to get. Basically, the heavenly vision has gone out of their lives. It's true of many Christians, and I pray that it's not true of any of us watching this morning. And the book of Judges is our warning in this whole matter. Why did these people fall short of finishing the job, going the whole course? I think for many of them it was because they became weary in well-doing. The battle was long and it was drawn out. It was spread over very many years, very exhausting. Can you just imagine that no sooner you finish and get one victory than you have to start fighting all over again? They didn't get a whole lot of rest from one battle to the next battle. Long, drawn out, they got weary. And in their weariness, they lost their vision. They lost heart. They just lost incentive. When on earth are we going to be able to enjoy some of the promise of the promised land? When, oh when, can we just sit back and relax and enjoy the milk and the honey? And amazingly, the New Testament's actually very, very encouraging to those who are weary. It doesn't just bang you over the head and say, don't get tired, don't do this. It's actually very, very encouraging. Galatians 6 verse 9 encourages us, let us not be weary in well-doing. For in due season, in God's due season, we shall reap if we don't faint. 1 Corinthians 15:58. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Hebrews 6:10, God is not unjust to forget your work and your labor of love. Jesus said to his disciples, who at that time were being drawn into the battle, he said in John chapter 14, verse 1, let not your heart be troubled. And again he said to his disciples in Matthew 24, verse 13, right at the end, he who endures to the end shall be saved. And we know that God even encouraged Joshua right at the beginning of the book of Joshua, be strong and be of good courage. Do not be afraid nor be dismayed, for the Lord is with you wherever you go. But as I say, we find these people in the book of Judges, discouraged, weary. Probably most of us have been there at some time or another. Sometimes it's very, very tempting just to give up. We know we mustn't get out of the battle, and yet we desperately want to get out of the battle and just have a bit of a rest. And for us as Christians, the battle's not out there taking on Philistines and people like that. The battle's all inside. And Paul even had that exact same battle. He said, in a sense, I've got this very strong desire just to pack it all in and go and be with the Lord, just to get some peace from the battle. But I also know that I have a duty to the Lord to fulfill. I've got to finish the course. I've got to get to the end. I'm caught between just wanting to give up and go home and keeping on fighting. And that, I believe, was a lot of Paul's Christian life. And I believe it's a temptation to all of us as believers. But the good thing about God is that He knows all about it. He understands. As I said, the New Testament is actually very, very understanding of this. The New Testament is full of exhortation and encouragement to just keep on going, to not give up. So the first reason why these people settled down too soon was, I believe, just discouragement. It wasn't because they didn't have any victories. They had victory after great victory. But it was just because they said, there's no end to the battle. We'll never be finished. So in weariness and in discouragement, they just settle down too soon. But the book of Judges also shows us something very, very important in the Lord. Every single time through that book that those people stirred themselves again and got right with God and turned to God, they found that God was there, ready, willing, waiting for them, ready to go on with them. One day these people were down in the dumps. The next day they're up in victory. It was one of those, for them, it was those Christian lives that are always up and down. But the incredible thing is, every time they turned their faces to the Lord, every single time they found that God was there waiting for them. The Lord hasn't given up on you. No matter where you are this morning, God hasn't just washed His hands of you. He's always ready and waiting when you just repent and you turn to Him. And I think that's the great, great lesson of the book of Judges. But what was the effect of this loss, of this stopping too soon? I believe more than anything, they just got to the place where they only saw things that were near. They lost sight of God's eternal purpose. They lost sight of what Paul calls in Philippians 3 verse 14, the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. And I see so many people in that place right now. They have a God who is very small, and a God who is very much the God of today and tomorrow, definitely not the God of next week. And I believe God would urge us to pick our fights at this time. I don't believe masks or no masks is a fight worth fighting. I really don't. It's immediate, it's today, possibly tomorrow. This time next year, you're going to look back and say, why, oh why, oh why did I waste so much time fussing and faffing about stupid masks? Even things like once saved, always saved, or pre-trib, mid-trib, post-trib, are things not worth fighting about. Do you really think that you're going to go sidling up to people in heaven one day, there they are worshiping before the throne of God, down on their faces before God, and you're going to sidle up and say, nyeh, 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 nyeh. It was pre-trib after all. I was right. So, I can promise you, you're just going to be so happy that you're there. You're just going to be so grateful that you're there before the throne. And you won't give a hoot whether you got there before, in the middle, or afterwards. You're not going to give a hoot. Don't think you're taking up some big righteous stand on masks and no masks. No. Galatians 5:1, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which Christ Jesus has made you free. And do not be entangled again in all these yokes of bondage. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Fix your eyes on eternity. Be found faithful where God has called you to be. Be doing what God has told you to do. Your battle is not against politicians and policemen and officials and whatever else. Your battle is not against flesh and blood, but your battle is against principalities, powers, great wickedness in very high places. That's where the battle is. King David got into the most trouble in all of his life when he got out of step with God and he was in the wrong place at the wrong time. 2 Samuel 11, verses 1 and 2. It happened in the spring of that year. At the time, at the right time when kings normally and ought to go out to battle, that David sent Joab and his servants with him and all Israel. And they destroyed the people of Ammon and they besieged Rabbah. But David remained at Jerusalem. Then it happened. That's when it happened, Scripture says. One evening that David arose from his bed, walked on the roof of the king's house, and from the roof he saw a woman bathing. And the woman was very, very beautiful to behold. Wrong place, wrong time. Now, I'm very wary of that word vision. People say you must have a vision, like you must have an appendix or something. It's like you've got to have one. Or you must get the vision of my church. I've got news for you. This church has absolutely no vision. Zero vision other than Christ and Him crucified. There is no other vision. But what did happen to the people of Israel is that they just lost sight of things not seen. How can you see things that are not seen? But Paul says in 2 Corinthians 4:18, the things which are seen are temporary, today and tomorrow. But the things which are not seen are eternal. They lost sight of eternity because they were obsessed about today and tomorrow. They lost heavenly vision because they became satisfied too soon. It was all good so far. For them, it was going well. They were winning great victories, taking a lot of land. But the good became the enemy of the best. And they were caught in this catch-22. You see, if we lose heavenly vision, then we settle down too soon. If we settle down too soon, we very quickly lose heavenly vision. It's this vicious circle that we get into. What do I mean by settling down too soon? I mean just losing your fighting spirit. In 1 Samuel 13, it came to the point where the Philistines took all the weapons of war away from Israel. Every farmer in Israel had to journey miles and miles to go to the one blacksmith who could sharpen their tools for them. They weren't allowed any weapons of war. All the sharp instruments had been taken away. And the whole spirit of war and fighting was just taken from them. And so too today, the strategy of the great enemy of our inheritance is always to just take the fighting spirit out of us. What a lot of damage the Philistine spirit still does to Christians today, just to take away all your fighting out of you. How's your prayer life? How is your prayer life right now? When you get a WhatsApp prayer request or hear of a pressing need, do you go to war over that need? Or is it, shame, man. Sorry to hear that. And then you just carry on with life. There was a time when many of us were mighty warriors in prayer. We fought God's battles in prayer. And yesterday we asked the Lord for 101 things. But do we really still battle through and fight through until the victory is won in prayer? There's a life of terrible bondage. There's a servant of God really having a hard time. Many, many other calls for battle. But where are the prayers who will take up those things and will not give up and not stop fighting and pressing through until the victory is won? Where are the men and women who will step up and stand in the gap for others? Where's the voice crying in the wilderness? Where are the people willing to take up their cross and follow Jesus? Where are the people who sincerely seek to know Christ in the power of his resurrection, in the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable even unto death? The warring spirit has gone out from so much of the church, and it's been a very, very long and very clever strategy of the devil. Lose the spirit of spiritual battle, and you will stop short of finishing the job. And the next thing that caused these people to settle down too soon was the spirit of the world coming in. What is the spirit of the world? It's the spirit of let's just have a good time. Israel looked at the people around them and said, these people are not having as much of a rough time as we are. They're far better off. Our life is just one long battle, and there they are partying, having a great time. I believe there came a day for Israel when they just started looking at the people around them. Up to that point, Israel had always given all the tribes around them a hard time. But Israel lost the fighting spirit. And the world was having a good time because the church was no longer fighting. And instead of shunning the world, they made friends with the world and all of their gods, because their gods were just so much easier to get along with. The Philistine gods were so easy to get on with. They weren't like this holy, righteous, demanding God. Compromise is a hugely dangerous thing, especially dangerous to your inheritance. Try to be on good terms with the world and have an easy time, and it will result in you losing a huge chunk of your inheritance. But as I said earlier, the incredible thing is that God didn't give up. And whenever the people took up the battle again, turned again to the Lord's side, and to fight the good fight of faith, they found God there waiting for them. And so you have stories in the book of Judges of people like Deborah and Gideon and his 300, and even Samson. And yes, Samson should be an encouragement to us, me probably more than anybody, because he was a failure in so many ways. But we see with Samson that even if God gets just a little chance, a little opportunity, he will use it to his glory. You see, you may not think all that much of Samson, but do you think any better of yourself? We're all failures. We've all fallen short. We've all fallen miserably in different areas at different times. We've all been discouraged. We've all been tempted to give up. We've all stopped too soon. We've all compromised at times. We've all been wary in well-doing. But I believe God is saying it is time to take up the sword again. Take up the battle again. And the incredible thing is, when you do that, when you repent, when you turn back to God, you will find he's sitting waiting for you. Gideon, Deborah, Samson, all the others through the book of Judges found that to be so true. God was waiting for them. But there's one who's possibly and probably better than all of them. And that's a woman called Ruth. What a lovely book of spiritual recovery the book of Ruth is. And I really encourage you in the week just to go and read the book of Ruth again. What a picture of God's patience. What a picture of God's readiness to just answer and to take advantage of every opportunity. How does Ruth begin? And it came to pass in the days when the judges judged. The book of Ruth also happened at this time, in the time of Judges. As we say, a terrible time in the history of Israel. But God was ready and waiting to change the whole picture. Two different pictures, the judges and Ruth, both happening at the same time. God at work in a very dark day. Ruth, the story of one faithful woman in the midst of great apostasy, who never took up a sword. She didn't go out and fight and do great battles. But all she did was just to be simply willing to obey and to trust God. That's all. A pagan woman, not even a Jewish believer. Just willing to put her faith and trust in God, and God was there waiting for her. And the book of Ruth ends with incredible words. Boaz begot Obed. Obed begot Jesse. Jesse begot David. Out of that comes the whole line of King David. And go and read Matthew and the genealogies. Out of that line comes the birth of Jesus. We are in a great battle, and it is long and drawn out. Even this stupid little COVID battle was supposed to be 2 weeks. Do you remember March last year? We're just going to have a lockdown for 2 weeks, and here we are nearly a year later. It's long and it's drawn out, and we can get weary in the fight. We can become discouraged, but the danger is in giving up too soon. We can be pushed and pressurized into compromise. Many, many believers right now are being pressurized as never before by the enemy into just simply compromising. But we will find that the Lord is ready every time. God is waiting for you, and he's wanting to help you and to strengthen you and to come alongside you and to be with you right to the end of the fight. He will help you until the day is done. Amen. Let's pray. Father, I pray this morning especially for those who are discouraged, weary, in danger of giving up, danger of compromise, just saying it's been so long and the battle is so hard. I pray for each and every one this morning, Lord, that there be not a turning from you, not a turning to the world and its ways. But God, we see this morning the great and incredible truth that if we will just turn to you, if we will turn from what we are and where we are and turn again to you, you're ready and you're waiting. and you're ready and waiting to come and strengthen and to stand and to encourage and to see us to the end. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that the battle is not ours, but it is yours. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.